The next few lectures I'll be taking, so let me introduce myself. I'm Prakash Nagarkari. I'm the Associate Dean for Basic Science at the School of Medicine. So I joined this school about 3 years ago. I moved from Medical College of Virginia at Richmond, where I used to teach medical students as well. And prior to that, I was a professor at Virginia Tech, and I used to teach the entire immunology class to the undergraduates as well as graduate students. So in today's class, I'll be talking about hypersensitivity reactions, and again, I want to make it, keep this as informal as possible. So anytime you have any questions, you want to stop me, you know, please feel free to do so. So this sounds familiar. There is a guy waiting with a bouquet of flowers, you know, waiting for his date to arrive, and he inhales the pollen, and what happens is that he is severely allergic to pollen, and as a result, after, you know, within a few minutes, what happens is, you know, his nose and eyes started running, or watery eyes, and he starts sneezing, and he looks really miserable. And so the girl arrives, looks at him, he looks pathetic, and so she just dumps him and goes away. So this is an instance which describes how an immune response can be triggered against an innocuous material such as pollen. So basically, you need to understand the fact that the immune system cannot distinguish between what is pathogenic or what is harmful versus what is non-pathogenic or something what is harmless. What the immune system can recognize is the epitopes or the antigenic determinants or the chemical structure. And sometimes what happens therefore is that without realizing, the immune system can go haywire, start producing a very strong immune response. And that strong immune response can in turn cause severe damage to your own cells or tissues. And that situation is called as hypersensitivity. So hyper means increased, sensitivity is responsiveness. So when your immune system responds in a disproportionate way and starts destroying your own cells or tissues, and that reaction is called as the hypersensitivity reaction. So just to go through the health impact of allergies, currently in the United States there are 19.6 million people suffering from allergic rhinitis, chronic sinusitis about 32 million people, contact dermatitis and eczema about 5.8, skin rashes 12, asthma about 9 to 12 million people suffer from this. And anaphylaxis, usually about 1 or 2 million people have anaphylactic shocks. So that indicates the gravity of this clinical disease, what we call as allergies or hypersensitivity reactions. So basically, hypersensitivity is defined as excessive immune response, increased immune response in a sensitized individual. And that's important to know. What we mean by sensitized is that when we come across these antigens or so-called allergens, the first response is, you know, we produce certain antibodies or we produce some immune response. So that itself may not be harmful. But when we come across the same antigen or same allergen second time, the second round, then we mount a very strong reaction. So therefore, we call this as in an individual who is sensitized, previously sensitized, then the immune response gets triggered and mounts a very strong reaction, thereby leading to this hypersensitivity reaction. So Gell and Coombe, several years ago, classified the hypersensitivity reactions into four types. They're called as, based on the clinical disease, actually. And as you'll see that in the type 1, type 2, type 3, there'll be some overlap in terms of the mechanisms. But clinically, they were classified into type 1, type 2, type 3, and type 4. And the first three types, type 1, 2, and 3, they were called as immediate hypersensitivity reactions. And typically, the name itself suggests, the immediate means that as soon as you're exposed to this antigen or allergen for the second round, you mount an immune response that triggers the hypersensitivity reaction within a matter of few minutes or few hours. So it's a very rapid reaction. So that's why it's called immediate. And one of the other characteristic features is that this hypersensitivity reaction is triggered by the antibody molecules. Okay? So therefore it's a humoral immune response. You can transfer the antibodies and you can transfer the disease. The type 4 hypersensitivity reaction, in contrast, is quite distinct in that it's called a delayed type hypersensitivity reaction, which means that it takes about 24 to 48 hours to manifest after you come across the antigen. And also, it's mediated by the T lymphocytes. So therefore, it belongs to the cell-mediated immunity, or the other arm of the immune response. So what I'll do now is basically try to introduce you to all the four hypersensitivity reactions without going through the details, and then we'll look at each one of these and try to go through each one of those, address those in detail. So basically what happens in type 1 hypersensitivity reactions, which we commonly call as allergies, is that when you come across the antigen or allergen, some individuals selectively produce a distinct type of antibodies called as IgE antibodies. Okay? So if you are exposed to an antigen, normally we produce IgG antibodies, but some individuals might produce large amounts of IgE antibodies. Then those individuals become susceptible to that type of allergic reactions. And then there are what are called as mast cells found in the tissues and the skin, and basophils, equivalent of mast cells found in the blood, that have Fc receptors for high affinity receptors for the Fc portion of IgE antibodies. So therefore, these IgE antibodies will immediately go and bind to the mast cells, and now the mast cells are all the time armed with these IgE antibodies. So in such a sensitized individual, you come across the antigen again, the antigen is going to bind to the IgE antibodies, and that cross-links the Fc receptors, and that triggers the mast cells to get activated. So the mast cell feels like there is something pathogen, some foreign object is there, so it starts producing histamine, leukotrienes, all these mediators that are essential for triggering an strong inflammatory response. So the clinical disease that you see is triggered by histamine and all the mediators that are produced by the mast cells, and we'll go through those in detail later on. In type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, the example is mismatched blood transfusion. You know that we have to match the blood groups before you do transfusion. And so if there is a mismatch in blood transfusion, what happens is that if this is a foreign red blood cell, then there will be antibodies that are this is the foreign red blood cell, then these antibodies can bind to what are called as killer cells, and these killer cells could be macrophages, neutrophils, and so on. And these cells get activated and they immediately kill the target cells. Or in mismatched blood transfusions, there could be antibodies such as IgM antibodies that can activate the complement, and complement can cause literally holes in the cell membrane of these red blood cells and destroy all those foreign red blood cells. And the complement fragments that are activated can in turn activate the mast cells and cause severe kind of anaphylactic shock. In type 3 hypersensitivity reaction, it's called as immune complex disease. So normally when we produce antibodies against an antigen, there is an immune complex that is formed. There is an antigen-antibody complex is formed. And these complexes in a normal individual are efficiently cleared by the phagocytic cells in the liver or the spleen. But in certain individuals, what happens is these immune complexes are not efficiently cleared, and they get deposited, and these immune complexes they activate the complement, and the activated complement, again, similar to here, is some of the fragments are also called anaphylatoxins. They can activate the mast cells, and ultimately you find there is infiltration of the neutrophils, and these immune complexes get deposited in the blood vessels or at certain organs or sites, and they can constantly trigger the immune response, and as a result of which you develop chronic inflammation, and that can result in severe damage to your own cells or tissues. And lastly, the type 4 hypersensitivity reaction is the best example I can give you, and we'll discuss that later on, is immune response against tuberculosis, wherein you find that the antigen is processed by the macrophage or dendritic cells, and this antigen is presented with the class 2 MHC molecules to the T helper cells, particularly the Th1 cells. And the Th1 cells in turn produce cytokines such as the macrophage activating factor, interferon gamma, tumor necrosis factor, and so on. And these macrophages then try to kill those bacteria. But as we'll discuss later on, that sometimes when the macrophages are not able to kill the bacteria efficiently, then what happens is this process goes on and on, and chronic inflammation or inflammatory response triggers a severe damage to the host, as it is as seen in tuberculosis, where you start seeing severe damage to the lung tissue caused by chronic inflammatory response that is triggered by the type 4 hypersensitivity reaction. So let's start discussing the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction, which is commonly also called as certain types of the clinical disease also called as anaphylaxis. So this is a guinea pig. That's the best I could draw, actually. That if you take a guinea pig and inject it with egg albumin, okay, the first time you inject with egg albumin, you do not get you don't see any response. In other words, there's no clinical signs of disease. So of course there is an immune response that is triggered, but we don't see any clinical signs of disease. So it's like vaccination, so you inject a foreign antigen into the guinea pigs. But you wait for 2 weeks and you repeated the injection with the same egg albumin into the guinea pigs, and you find that within a matter of few minutes, the guinea pig dies from asphyxia, breakdown or its collapse of the respiratory system, there is smooth muscle constriction, and there is also shock, there is a drop in blood pressure, and the guinea pig, if not treated, is going to die in a few minutes. So this phenomenon was called as anaphylaxis. Ana is away from, phylaxis is protection in Greek. So therefore, this is an immune response where normally an antigen should trigger an immune response and protect you against, a foreign antigen. But in this case, the immune response is killing the host by mounting a strong reaction. So what is happening basically in this situation is that the first time you immunize the guinea pig with egg albumin, the guinea pig starts producing IgE antibodies. And so now the mast cells are armed with IgE antibodies. So when you immunize this same guinea pig second time, then what happens is basically these guinea pigs are going to mount, the albumin is going to bind to the IgE, cross-link the mast cells, Fc receptors for IgE, and the mast cells produce histamine as well as other mediators. And histamine and the leukotrienes that we'll talk about later on are primarily responsible for two clinical symptoms. One is called as the bronchoconstriction. So there's a constriction of smooth muscles, and as a result of which, there is the guinea pigs are not able to breathe, and also there is vasodilatation, in which there is gaps created. If this is the blood vessel which is lined by the endothelial cells, you find that histamine can cause gaps between the endothelial cells, because of which you find that there is loss of vascular fluid, and that results in a shock and drop in blood pressure. And we could potentially save the guinea pig from this, the clinical disease, by injecting epinephrine, which reverses the effect in terms of it is a vasoconstrictor and smooth muscle relaxant. So, that would be the immediate treatment for anaphylaxis. So basically, how is that, what is the mechanism by which you mediate an immune response, type 1 hypersensitivity reaction? So if this is the pollen or ragweed or whatever antigen, you find that first it is internalized by the macrophages or dendritic cells, and that associates with the class 2 MHC molecules, and then it's expressed on the membrane in association with class 2 MHC molecules, and you have studied already the antigen processing and presentation. Then those or that antigen along with MHC activates the T helper cell type 2 or TH2 cells. Okay, and again, precisely we don't know why it activates TH2, why not TH1 cells, and we could go and discuss these later on, but it is also believed that there are certain types of dendritic cells which selectively activate TH2 cells, whereas certain other types of dendritic cells can activate selectively TH1 cells. But in this case, the TH2 cells get activated, and the TH2 cells, or T helper cell type 2, typically produce IL-4, IL-5, and IL-13. Okay? And these cytokines selectively activate the B cells in such a way that the B cells now start producing, they differentiate into plasma cells and start secreting IgE antibodies. So the B cells are armed with IgM, right? And there is a class switch when the B cells get activated. So this class switch, because of these cytokines, instead of producing IgG antibodies, they start producing IgE type of antibodies. Now, these IgE antibodies will bind to the mast cells, and now the mast cells are armed with the IgE antibodies, and then when you get exposed to the same pollen or same allergen, they will cross-link the Fc receptors on the mast cells, and the mast cells secrete these granules, which consists of histamine, tryptase, kininogenase, eosinophil chemotactive factor, as well as the activated mast cells also synthesize certain new mediators, and these new mediators include the leukotrienes and prostaglandins. Now, leukotrienes also behave the same way as histamine, except that they are almost 100 to 1,000 times more potent than histamine. So, basically, all these factors are responsible for ultimately triggering the type 1 hypersensitivity reaction. Now, it's interesting to note that, again, the immunologists are trying to address the question, why is it that some individuals produce TH2 response, or why is it that we produce IgE antibodies and certain other individuals do not? And one interesting observation epidemiologically they have made is that in Western countries where there is less incidence of bacterial infections or parasitic infections, you find that there seems to be more activation of TH2 response. Whereas when you have more incidence of bacterial infections, parasitic or fungal infections, that seems to trigger the TH1 response. Okay? So therefore, what happens is that when there is a TH1 response triggered, that suppresses the TH2, whereas when the TH2 response is triggered, that suppresses the TH1. So in this case, maybe because of the environmentally, what happens is people living in the West, the incidence of allergies is more, probably because we do not have those infections that trigger TH1 response, so therefore we are more inclined to produce TH2 response, and that's the reason why you might be producing more of IgE antibodies compared to certain other individuals. So in addition to the fact that cross-linking Fc receptors by IgE can lead to mast cell degranulation, you'll also notice that complement components such as C3A and C5A, those are activated following an antigen-antibody reaction. And these complement fragments, C3A and C5A, can also bind to the mast cells because the mast cells have receptors for these, and that's why they're called as anaphylatoxins. So therefore, in type 2 hypersensitivity and type 3 hypersensitivity reactions, where complement gets activated, this complement can also activate the mast cells by virtue of the fact that mast cells have receptors for these. In addition, the mast cells can also get activated by certain drugs such as calcium ionophores, codeine, morphine, and melatonin. And again, mast cells have receptors for these, or the drugs can directly act on these mast cells and cause certain biochemical changes that can lead to release of histamine and other factors. So there is a typical IgE-mediated mast cell activation, and then there is this alternative pathway involving mechanisms that are independent of IgE. So basically, when mast cells are activated, there is a release of preformed granules. That is, mast cells already have these granules, and those include the histamine and all these other factors. But when mast cells get activated, there is also activation of arachidonic acid, and that is metabolized through cyclooxygenase or lipoxygenase pathways into production of prostaglandins and leukotrienes. So prostaglandins and leukotrienes are activated only when are produced only when the mast cells get activated. Otherwise, a normal mast cell, a naive mast cell, will not actually be synthesizing the leukotrienes, which also play a critical role in allergic reactions. So this is a slide that lists all the factors that are produced by the mast cells, the neutrophil chemotactic factor, eosinophil chemotactic factor, leukotriene B4, histamine, platelet activating factor, and all these. Basically, as you can see, what is happening is the mast cell is looking at as though there is an infection, and we'll talk about how mast cells play a role in parasitic infections. So basically, mast cells are thinking there is an infection, so we need to trigger a strong immune response. So the mast cell wants all the other components of the immune system to come at the site where there is infection, and those include neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, and basophils. Okay, so that's one of the mechanisms. And also the mast cell want to cause vasodilation, because the inflammation helps control the infection. So the inflammation wants to, at the site of infection, you want to have more complement, more antibodies, so that's why there is vascular leak. So that allows the serum proteins to migrate into the sites where the infection is located, and also to dilute out some of the toxins if they are present. And again, the function of the bronchial smooth muscle constriction is that if you're inhaling a toxic material, the immune system is trying to, try to make sure that, you breathe less of the toxins or less of these pathogenic bacteria or infections. So that's the reason, I guess, that's the reason or the function of the some of the factors such as histamine, prostaglandins, and leukotrienes in trying to cause the bronchial smooth muscles. So in a normal situation where there's an infection, and if this is carefully regulated, then it's great. It's beneficial to the host. But what happens, as I said, is that sometimes the immune response, the mast cells get activated to such an extent. It could be environmental factors, it could be genetic factors, it could be, the basic mechanisms as to how your immune system is triggered, that sometimes excessive production of these molecules or mediators can cause severe damage to your own system. And as I showed in the guinea pig case, that a severe induction of histamine and all the leukotrienes can lead to asphyxia, and the guinea pigs can die from bronchial muscle constriction and loss of fluid and shock. Are there any questions thus far? Yes, sir.
Does it matter of the amount of allergen present on the basis of how big a response the mast cell releases, or is it?
Yes, up to a certain extent, it does depend on to what extent the levels of allergens are formed. For example, we have pollen in the environment all the time, but when the levels of pollen increases, like say during springtime, when there is a lot of flowers and all that, then people tend to have more allergies, which indicates that the levels of allergies might depend or might correlate with the amount of antigen or allergens that are found. And the same thing can be said about people who are allergic to house dust mites, that if you are living in a house or an apartment which has got carpets that are kind of humid or moist, where there's more opportunity for the house dust mites to flourish, then you have more chances of getting a more severe asthma or allergic response compared to you are living in a same individual living in a situation where you have hardwood floors, or you know, you don't have carpets, and there's less chance for the house dust mites to flourish. So, but we'll talk about later on when we talk about desensitization, is that we try to, the immunologists have tried to discover a way that you can start injecting very small amounts and try to increase the dose of the antigen, and that time the immune system can be tricked into switching from IgE to IgG antibodies. But that's a good question. The dose of the antigen does play a critical role in terms of the severity of the disease. Any, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I was wondering on when we have a sensitized reaction, we learned with especially the primary reaction that you have a majority of IgM mediated response with some IgG, IgE, whichever the class switching occurs. In hypersensitivity reactions, when you have that first sensitization to the antigen, is there actually a greater propensity for IgE class switching, or is it the same where you would actually still have IgM antibodies as opposed to a lot of IgE?
Right. So basically, the naive B cells are armed with IgM and IgD antibodies. Okay. So during the primary response, we produce mostly IgM and maybe little bit of, very little bit of IgG. But when you encounter the antigen, same antigen second time, there is what is called as class switching, where the B cells start producing either IgG, IgA, IgE, or you know, any some other class of antibodies. But in this case, what happens is that most instances, we tend to produce more IgGs, okay, and less of IgA, IgE, and so on and so forth. But in this case, the individuals who are sensitized or individuals who are susceptible to allergies, for some reason, which is not very clear, it could be environmental, genetic, it could be so many different reasons, the IgM producing B cells switch from, you know, IgM production to IgE production instead of IgG production. And the reason for that is believed to be the fact that in those individuals, they seem to produce more Th2 helper cells, which produce more of IL-4, IL-5, IL-13. That drives the B cells to differentiate more into IgE production rather than IgG production. Yes, ma'am.
On the previous slide, I think
Basically, these are all mediators that are produced by the mast cells. So the tryptase seems to activate the complement. Again, complement, I don't know whether you already studied complement. I think you have. So basically, it's a serum protein that is found in the, you know, in the serum as well as in body fluids. So an antigen-antibody reaction takes place. It activates the complement components, and that in turn activates the C3a and C5. And those are the ones which can in turn activate the mast cells and cause, you know, further activation of mast cells. Any other questions? So some of the clinical examples of allergies include, you know, hay fever and asthma, and that is common to pollen, house dust, pets, for example. Urticaria or hives that is triggered by exposure to certain drugs, food, clinical characteristics include reddening and itching of the skin, systemic anaphylaxis similar to what I described with guinea pigs that can also result from injection of penicillin, drugs such as penicillin, as well as insect bites. And again, this is a picture of how the eczema looks, allergic reaction in the skin. There's a wide range of allergens. There are over 75 to 100 different allergens or potential allergens that you can be exposed to. And those include the grass, pollen, weeds, food such as crab, shrimp, potato, tuna. The reason why you're allergic, some individuals are allergic to the pets, include the fact that you know, you inhale the epidermal cells that are shed by these pets. If you are allergic to mouse, you cannot be an immunologist. When graduate students try to join my lab, I always ask them, you know, are you allergic to mice? Because all the immunology research primarily is done either in humans or in mice. So I make sure that they are not allergic to mice, otherwise they can't do the research. Insect bites, house dust, molds, drugs, and all that kind of stuff. And the reason, as I told you, why certain individuals develop severe anaphylaxis is because the bee, when they're bitten by a bee, is that the bee venom has what is called as melanin. And I showed in my previous slide that the melanin can directly bind to the mast cells and activate the mast cells and cause mast cell activation. So this is independent of the IgE antibody production, and that can directly trigger mast cells and cause massive anaphylaxis. The reason why we are allergic to house dust mites is because the house dust mites secrete these fecal pellets, and gross as it may sound, that we inhale this and start producing IgE antibodies against these fecal pellets or contents that are found in these, and that's how you try to develop, and that's how you get develop allergies. So basically, allergies are triggered by the chemical constituents of the allergens include the fact that most of the allergens are proteins or they are haptens. These are small molecules that are bound to the proteins. So there are certain drugs, for example, you can be allergic to because of the fact that these drugs act as haptens. They can, when injected in vivo, they can bind to certain proteins, and that can trigger an immune response. And the second characteristic is that they typically secrete the IgE antibodies as well as the cytokines IL-4, alpha, IL-13, and activate the Th2 response. And the other important constituent is the IgE antibodies. These are perhaps the only antibodies that can bind to the mast cells by virtue of the fact that mast cells have high affinity receptors for these IgE antibodies. And cross-linking of Fc receptors of IgE leads to mast cell degranulation that we talked about. And then it activates the mast cells. Mast cells release the histamine and other factors, and those are responsible for triggering the inflammation, and as evident by swelling and redness. If you are allergic to a wide range of antigens or allergens, they try to do a test on the back because it's got a large surface. Again, based on the levels of your response, you can try to measure to what extent you're allergic to. Now, it's important to remember that if you go to a physician or an allergologist and say that you potentially have allergies, one of the things that they do is to measure the levels of IgE antibodies, right? But it's important to remember that even if your report comes saying that you have increased levels or high levels of IgE, that does not necessarily mean that you're allergic to a specific certain allergens. There are other diseases or other clinical conditions which also trigger high levels of IgE. So in addition to the allergies, it's been shown that people who are suffering from helminthic worm infections or parasitic infections, they tend to have high levels of IgE antibodies. Then there are certain immunological deficiency diseases such as hyper IgE syndrome or Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome, which is an X-linked immunodeficiency syndrome, where they seem to produce more of these IgE antibodies. And then there is bronchopulmonary aspergillosis and IgE myeloma. Myeloma is basically a B lymphocyte becoming cancer. Okay, so if a B cell that is producing IgE antibodies becomes cancerous, then what happens is you start producing more and more of the same IgE antibodies, and a high level of IgE antibodies can also indicate cancer that is triggered of the B lymphocytes that produce IgE antibodies. It's very rare, but it can happen as well. Now, in terms of the treatment, there are, as you know, epinephrine is very commonly used, and there are beta agonists, alpha blockers, and phosphodiesterase inhibitors. And interestingly, they found that all these compounds which trigger cyclic AMP seem to provide relief from the symptoms because, again, the mast cells also express the adrenergic receptors, whereas the alpha agonists and beta blockers, which downregulate the cyclic AMP, seem to worsen the symptoms of allergic reactions. So in terms of treatment, So far, there is no cure for allergies. Okay, and immunologists are trying to understand the mechanisms, they're trying to understand the genetics and so on to come up with something potentially that they can find a cure. But so far, there's no cure for allergies. All that you can provide is symptomatic relief. So there are antihistamines, which are compounds that mimic the histamine and bind to the histamine receptors so that the real histamine cannot activate these the target cells. So there are antihistamines available. There are beta agonists that we talked about, and then there is inhalants like chromalin sodium that causes inhibition of calcium influx in the mast cells. So mast cells, when they're activated, one of the first signs is that there is increase in calcium influx, and so chromalin sodium tries to block that, thereby preventing the mast cell degranulation. And there is the phosphodiesterase inhibitors. And lastly, there is what is also known as immunotherapy or hyposensitization. So in this particular procedure, what happens is that, let's say this individual is allergic to a certain allergen and it's very severe, it's difficult to keep it under control, then what they can go through is what is called as desensitization or hyposensitization, in which they try to inject small doses of antigen gradually over a period of months, and slowly they try to increase the levels of the antigen. In addition, they also come up with antigens or allergens that are modified. You know, you synthesize, if you're allergic to, let's say, ragweed, you try to modify that through genetic engineering, to modify that antigen in such a way that you try to deceive the immune system in trying to see as though it looks like ragweed, but you're trying to make the immune system produce more IgG antibodies rather than IgE antibodies. And typically, the way the immunotherapy works is that normally these individuals produce more of IgE and very little of IgG, but after gradually increasing the dose of allergen, you find that these individuals start producing less and less of IgE antibodies and more of IgG antibodies. And there is a lot of research being done in this area, and it's also been shown that recently they discovered what is called as T suppressor cells or regulatory T cells, which suppress the immune response. And they find that when you start doing this kind of treatment, in addition, you also produce the T regulatory cells or T suppressor cells that seem to suppress the immune response against IgE. And so there are potentially multiple mechanisms, but in the serum, you'll find that slowly the IgE levels drop and IgG levels increase. And so that's the mechanism by which the hyposensitization works. And lastly, the anti-IgE antibodies. Recently, they have discovered that you can inject antibodies against IgE and potentially use that for preventing the allergic reaction. But it's important to remember that these antibodies are directed against the Fc portion of IgG. If I can show you a slide. Okay. These antibodies are directed against the Fc portion of IgG and not the antigen binding site, because if you direct it against that, you know, then potentially it can cross-link the IgE and it can cause more severe disease, right? You don't want to do that. So these antibodies against IgE bind to the Fc portion and block the Fc portion, so that now these IgE antibodies that are here, that are circulating, cannot bind to the mast cells. So basically they form an immune complex and then they are cleared. Okay, so thereby lowering the level of IgE antibodies and without causing hyperactivation of the IgE by cross-linking. Are there any questions on that?
I have a quick question.
Yes, sir.
When you have an infection with a helmet,
right.
What tells it to activate the eosinophils rather than the mast cells?
Right. I was going to just show you that slide. I'll talk about that. In fact, it was perfect timing. So basically, the question is, why are we producing IgE antibodies? Why are these mast cells getting activated and so on and so forth? So it has been shown that in countries where the parasitic infections are rampant, you have high levels of Ig antibodies, and they've shown that Ig antibodies seem to be playing a protective role against parasitic infections. So this is typically a parasite or a parasite that is located in the gut, in the gut lumen. And what happens is that this parasite sheds these antigens, okay, and these antigens will then cross through the gut mucosa and enter into the lamina propria immune cells or to the regional lymph nodes which are lining the gut. And these antigens are processed and presented by the macrophage or dendritic cells. They will activate the T helper cells, the Th2 cells. The Th2 cells will make the B cells produce IgE antibodies that will activate the mast cells. And the mast cells produce all these eosinophil chemotactic factors. So in this case, the eosinophils seem to play a critical role in parasitic infections. So what happens therefore is that the eosinophil chemotactic factors will attract a large number of eosinophils. So that's why in parasitic infections you find that even these individuals have high levels of eosinophils. Okay, and sometimes it can be so high that it results into another severe disease, what is called as eosinophilia. So, but anyway, so the eosinophils are brought at this site where the parasite is located, and there are antibodies that are produced. So these antibodies will bind to the parasite and activate the eosinophils. The eosinophils have granules that are so cytotoxic, or they are so toxic to the parasite, that they can virtually cause holes in the parasite, and ultimately the parasite is killed and expelled from the gut lumen. Okay, so that's potentially the mechanism by which, very complex, but mechanism through which the mast cell degranulation can lead to activation of eosinophils and in turn leads to protection against parasitic infections. Does that address your question? Okay, any other questions on that? So, next, moving on to the type 2 hypersensitivity reaction, basically, as I said, if this is a foreign cell that is found in your system or your own cells, sometimes what happens is you produce antibodies against these, and these antibodies can activate either the complement or they can activate the macrophages by virtue of the fact that macrophages express Fc receptors for these antibodies, or they can activate the neutrophils. And activation of neutrophils through these antibodies, what is called as antibody-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity, can release the enzymes that are found in the macrophages or the neutrophils. And if this is a chronic inflammation, okay, this is a chronic process, then constantly the neutrophils are getting activated, macrophages getting activated, can cause severe damage to these cells. Either these could be foreign cells or it could be self cells, and that can lead to type 2 hypersensitivity reaction. Some of the examples of type 2 hypersensitivity reaction is drug-induced reaction to red blood cells, in which drugs that we or some individuals are allergic to can selectively bind to the red blood cells, or they can bind to the platelets or granulocytes. I'm showing you an example of red blood cells. And this can act as an antigen that can trigger the antibody molecules, production of antibodies. The antibodies will bind to these drugs, or they can bind to the red blood cells, or a combination of both. And that can in turn trigger the complement cascade. And the complement gets activated, lyses all the red blood cells. And the complement fragments can also activate the mast cells, and there could be anaphylaxis. So the red blood cells, these are the compounds of the drugs that seem to activate or bind to the red blood cells. There are these compounds which seem to activate the or bind to the granulocytes and trigger an immune response. And here these are the compounds which activate the platelets. But basically the mechanism is that by binding to certain cells of your own system, the cells look as though they are foreign, so you're trying to trigger an antibody response. Those antibodies will activate complement and kill these cells, and as a result also the complement activation can cause severe anaphylaxis through activation of the mast cells as well. Okay, I think we'll take a 10-minute break, and we'll discuss the rest of the talk.